Thank you for the committee to have given me the opportunity to present my results here. I'm very honored to be here. This is my first time in here. And I would also like to thank the audience because you are still here and you give me the opportunity to present my work. Thank you. So, I'm a professor at the University of Saint-Étienne and I work on the Rhodes common sense. And I will give you a little introduction before talking to you about my work. So, we are all Rhodes lovers, and of course, we tend to think that this Rhodes sense that we love in Rhodes is edited for ourselves or the human. But of course, this is not the case. And the reason why the plant is odorous and scent, there are two main reasons. The first one is the attraction of pollinators, and the second one is the defense against herbivores and pathogens. So first of all, attraction of pollinator. This is something which is really very important for the plant. Pollen has to be transported from one flower to another so that the plant reproduces. And this is usually used by using scents, and often, but not always, the insects get a reward. So it can be a nectar, it can be pollen, and sometimes it can also be a breeding site. And here you have some pictures. On the right, this is not a rose, this is a sage, pollinated by insects, and you have two roses, which are generally pollinated by bees or bumblebees, by generally insects. On the other hand, of course, you know that leaves of roses and of plants are attacked by different pathogens and insects, and rose flowers can also be attacked by these insects. Here you see Rosa canina and white rose attacked by the Caterpillar. And when the plant is attacked, it releases compounds which are toxic for the insects. So it's a need to defend themselves. And generally, these toxic compounds are on leaves, but sometimes they are on sepals. And here you can see on the right, the moss roses, maybe you know these roses, they are covered by glands. And these glands on the right, you can see, colored in violet, they are full of essential oil which repairs, which is toxic for the insects. There's even more, sometimes when a plant is attacked by insects, here you can see a tobacco which is attacked by this big caterpillar, Monica sexa, and when the plant is attacked, it releases volatile compound, and these volatile compounds, what they do, if they attract other insects, here they attract parasitic wasps, and these parasitic wasps will eventually damage the caterpillar and kill it. So basically, plants use volatile compounds also to cry for help when they are attacked. Well, if you come back to the rose, first of all, a little bit of chemical diversity of rose. You know very well that rose is heavily used for essential oil production. We use special cultivars for this purpose. One of the most famous is Rosa damascena. And this is not a huge production. It's about 15 to 20 tons a year. The main producers are Bulgaria and Turkey, but also India is a producer, of course. And you have to use 3 to 5 tons of petals only to have 1 liter, 1 kilogram of oil. So this is why this product is so expensive. The way the flowers are picked is by hand, see now, and the extraction process is also very very common. It's a simple distillator in which you put the petals and the essential oil evaporates and you can recover both the rose water, which you can use for facial medicine, and also the precious essential oil. So there are hundreds of different volatile compounds in only one rose, and I have to tell you a little bit about these volatile compounds. So they're small, they are volatile, which means that they can evaporate in the air, and we create them in our nose. And in our nose, we have olfactory receptors. And these volatile compounds bind to the olfactory receptor, and this binding which creates the perception that we have of an odor. So how do we study this rose scent? We don't distillate flowers because it leads to modification of the scent. We want to be as close as possible as the scent that is emitted. So we enclose the flower in a sort of a bag, and we pump air into this bag, and we have a device at the exit of the bag which traps the volatile compound. And then the trap is put in another device, a gas chromatography carbon to mass spectrometry. Don't bother, I'm not going to enter into detail. But what you have to understand is that you have at the beginning of the device, you have a mixture of different compounds, and these different compounds
are separated. And what you get in the end is
a chromatograph, and each peak on the chromatograph, here on the right, is a different compound. So you see here you have many compounds for only one rose. And you can have compounds which are present in a big quantity, such as the one on the right, but you can also have compounds which are present in very small quantities. And although these compounds are present in very small quantities, our nose may be able to smell this very small quantity. So there's another layer of complexity. It's not because a compound is not really abundant that we don't smell it. So it makes it complicated to study. So here is just an example of what you can have. On the right, you have the different layers of compounds, it doesn't matter. All you have to know is that they can be divided into different categories, so to make it more simple. So another topic that we have is where the flower is in the is in the flower. Of course, you know that there are different organs in the flower. You have petals, you have stamens, you have sepals, and you also have pistil. And all these parts of the flower are capable of emitting scent. And generally, the composition of the scent of these different organs is very different. But as you can see here, and as you all know, when you have a wild rose, like a Rosa Marechi, you have only 5 petals and lots of stamens. But in modern hybrids, you have many, many petals. Some roses have more than 100 petals. So when you have a white rose, what you smell is a combination of the scent that's emitted by the petals and the stamen. But when you have a modern rose with lots of petals, the main contribution to the scent is the petals. So if you zoom, we zoom a little bit more, we can make a slice of the petal, and as already described by some of the speakers, we have epidermal layers in the petals, and we have shown that both epidermal layers are capable of producing the scent. And you see in the rose, the shape of the upper epidermal cell is round. They have a round shape, they are conical papillae cells. And this cell, this shape of the cell contributes to the velvet aspect of the petals. So a little bit now about my research on rose scent. I'll be very quick. What we want to know is how the scent is produced in the rose by the petals. We want to know the enzymes, the genes that are responsible for this production, and hopefully, if we understand how it's produced, we will also understand why some rose cultivars are not producing this scent. So, of course, it's more complex than that. You all know what we call the typical rose scent, but thanks to the breeders, we can now find on the market roses with very different fragrances. You may know the tea fragrance, although nobody really knows if it has something to do with tea. You know we have flowers with anise fragrance. This is one
scent that you can find in most of the cut flower market, the one that you buy in your flower shop. There are many roses that smell like fruits, for example, peach, strawberry, clove. Clove is emitted generally by stamens and is very pleasant odor. And you also know, maybe, and probably know, the very special musk scent, which some people find pleasant and some people find not pleasant. But if you don't know this scent, I advise you to try it. So, of course, you know that some cultivars have no scent, especially the ones that were bred for the cut flower market. And you know that this rose were bred for beautiful flower, beautiful colors, also resistance to disease, and of course a long base life. And although it's not known why, the selection of this character has led to a loss of scent. And so here in the chromatogram, you see it's very flat with not many compounds compared to the one that I showed you before. So I like to get a little bit more into detail, more below, to try to make you understand what we are doing. So what we want to do is identify the biosynthetic pathway. So how is it possible? Generally, you have a precursor compound in the petal cells. And this precursor compound is generally not volatile, so not fragrant. And it will be transformed into an intermediary compound, which will then lead to the formation of the volatile set compound, for example, geranium. This is just an example. This cannot be done like that. For that, you have to have proteins, enzymes, and you have each enzyme which is capable of performing the one step. So enzyme one do the first step, and enzyme two do the second step, does the second step. And to make this enzyme, you need genes. So basically, what you have to understand is what to do is try to identify the genes responsible for each step of the process. This is a very hypothetical scheme. But in the real world, it's a bit more complicated because you have many genes, many cell compounds, and all of them are related. So just an example to show you what we have done so far. We compared two different roses, one Papamillon, which is really very fragrant, and another one, Rouge Mélian, which is almost scentless. And by different techniques, which I'm not going to detail, we compare the genes that are expressed, active, in the petals of these two roses. And as you can see here, we found one gene, which we named ERG1, which is very highly expressed, very active in the scent roses, and not active at all, not expressed in the non-fragrant roses, 7,000 times more in the fragrant cultivar. We did different experiments, and we found that all roses that were considered highly scented had a very high expression of these genes, and this gene was really highly expressed in petals of blooming flowers. So we did many experiments to prove that the gene had really a very important function in the production of some scent compounds. So basically, this is what we had done. We found the first step leading to the compound geranium. We don't have the second enzyme. We have still a little work to do. What I didn't tell you, because I don't have the time, is that we found that rose was very special. Some other plants, for example, geranium, pelargonium, produce geranium, but they don't produce it like the rose does. They use other enzymes. So the rose, we discovered that this pathway was novel, was original, and not all the plants had this pathway. And this is why we had the honor to publish in the very prestigious paper journal Science, and we made the cover with the rose. So to finish, we have some research perspective, of course. We would like to know why this gene is not expressed in the rose bred for the cut flower market. We would like to know if the lack of expression of this gene is the only
a cause of the lack of sand because, as I have shown you, there are many other genes that are involved. And we are in the process of tracing this evolution in botanical rows and during domestication. And we found that this novel function of the rows was already present in some white roses. To finish, I would just would like to show you some fragrant roses. I'm sure most of you know them, and there are many others, of course. This is just my top 10. I don't know any Indian rose, so I apologize that I wasn't able to show them that view. First, a botanical or semi botanical rose. This is, as already told, one of the ancestors of the hybrid modern roses, Rosalica, and it has a really sweet scent, although the species only has 4 or 5 petals. So it's very important. It's called, in France, it's called Rosemet, and it's really smells very good. There are also roses that don't smell very good. This cultivar and the species Rosafetida, it says that it has a bed bug or a mincing odor. I invite you to try it. And when I go to breeders to smell the rose, sometimes I smell roses that smell like cheese, not very pleasant. So there are roses that don't smell very good. Old roses, heritage roses, for example, this one, which is very famous, La Cartier. The reason I present that top 10 is also to so that you see how perfumers and breeders describe the scent of their roses, sometimes very poetic. And so this one has a very pronounced and very sweet fragrance, reminiscent of lavender and moisture. Another one, Malaisac Perret, this one in my garden is not very good because it has a lot of disease, but still, the flowers are very beautiful, and the scent is powerful and rich, with a peppery fragrance and reminiscent of that of damascus, which was used in perfumery. Just to identify the first scent that I talked before, and here in Constance 5, which is the Lady Justine Rose, you have a powerful myrrh scent mixed with spices. And if you want to know what a myrrh scent is, then you have to smell this rose. I love this one very much. This is Papillon. This is the rose that with which I made my discovery, so I love it. And it also has a very, very sweet scent, classical rose. And slightly lemon background, which you can really smell. It's also quite attacked by different diseases. Lots of roses have fruit scents, and this is just one example. Another rose from Lambertine, and here this is very poetic. Fragrance reminiscent of an orchard with fragrances of lemongrass and rose, supported by smells of grapefruit and apricot, with also scents of cinnamon and cloves and a hint of myrrh. It makes you want to smell the rose. Another scent which is often referred to is the tea scent. This tea scent, I don't think it has something to do with tea. The roses that were brought from China in the 19th century were cultivated by producers, and one of the producers that cultivated was called cat tea. And probably this is why these roses were named tea roses. Probably, because nothing is sure. But definitely, the tea scent is something very special, very specific. And if you want to smell it, because not many roses have powerful tea scent, I advise you this one, Anna, which is great at home business. Another scent is the anise, anethole, with very great smell of licorice, chicoriness, and leather. This is a very nice smell also, very, very, very light, but quite nice, in polica. I'm sure the French people know what polica is and why this rose is named polica. And last, I would just like to use this candle to say that sometimes perfumers have the possibility, and chemists have the possibility, to recreate the fragrance of roses by mixing scent compounds. So this was the case with this rose, which was bred by Leon in 2000. She has a powerful and persistent fragrance of fruit, peach, and this fragrance was integrated by Givenchy in the formula of a perfume, the perfume very irresistible. So roses benefit also to perfumers, of course. And last, I would thank you for your attention, and thank all the people that participate in this work, especially the PhD students, which helped me a lot in my research, Sarita Parmita, Ines Adra, and Corinda Thomas, all the people from my lab, and also all collaborators we have in France and in other countries. And thank you all.